notion of playing smart. This intentionality is huge. Notice the very last line on 1038 and the idea of habits. Francis Bacon is a great British philosopher, writer, scientist that we'll study in your senior year. In his classic essay of studies that we'll study together here in a few months when you're a senior, he says studies develop into habits. He makes a very interesting argument. He says, if you have a problem with your tummy and it's hurting, you go to the physician, the doctor. And the physician, doctor will give you some kind of medical protocol, some kind of pharmaceutical, some kind of medicine, some kind of activity, whatever. That is to say, let's fix the problem. Of course, you can't just take the medicine usually just one time. It has to be repeated for a number of days for the medicine to work. The same is true of studies. You can't fix your deficiencies. The thing in your neck is, of course, what we call it in our 303 intro lectures to 303 lectures right there on learnstrong.net on the homepage, right? You can't fix this thing in your neck without, of course, work, habits. You are your rhythms. What is it that you do repeatedly? That's what I will tell you makes you who you are. Think about that. Think about that. Now, there are some habits that obviously are demanded of us. Those physical habits. We have to eat. We have to drink. We have to do those things, no doubt. But there are intellectual habits as well that define who we are. And if we don't have some intentionality in our habits, we can't really control. And notice, that is the last word of the paragraph number one on 1039. Did you see it? The word control. Practice, rhythms have everything to do then with who we are. Because why? You can control situations. Life is not always going to be easy. Freshmen know this better than seventh graders. Can I say that out loud? Freshmen know this better than seventh graders. By the time you're a freshman, you start to realize it. My life is forever now going to be about this complicated thing called change. And I don't get to sit around forever and do whatever it is I did in the past. I have to, quote unquote, grow up, which is a really interesting kind of concept. That is to say, learning how to control the things that you can control in your life, learning how to not ask, why did this happen to me, but learning how to ask, why did this happen for me? That happens only through intentional practice. The very last thing for 2A messages, and I love this one, is his notion of what Walt Whitman will call, here in 24 months when we study in our junior year, we'll study the great poet Walt Whitman, what he calls in Song of Myself in passage 46-47, destroying the teacher. Now by that he doesn't mean that students pick up firearms and go and kill their teachers, not at all. What he means by that is this, that the mark of a great teacher, he says a great coach and teacher, that the mark of a great teacher is to help students outperform the teacher, to grow beyond the teacher, to destroy the teacher. In other words, your job as a student is to become better than your teachers. The job of a good teacher or coach is to make the student somehow better. Why? Because of change. The world that I grew up in as a child is not the world that you're growing up in. But the world that your grandson or granddaughter will grow up in is not the world that you grew up in. I like to say to gamers that there will come a moment when your grandson will say to you, you really sat and looked into some screen to play your game? And your grandson or granddaughter will look at you in the same way that you look, for example, at the older generation when you make fun of their Atari playing computer games days. Really? Because probably by then, your grandson or granddaughter will be in the game, actually playing in the game. It'll be a completely different world. The technology that we are not allowed to have out, that smartphone, was not available to your parents in the ways that it's available to you. I wonder what it'll be like in 20 years. Because my guess is that that smartphone that you're playing with in 20 years will not look that way at all. That's what we mean by change. In other words, your job is to always be preparing. Your job as a student is to get ready for the world that's coming out in front of you, and that will require of you that you somehow destroy the teacher. You're better than the teacher. Of course, I love that Dean Smith points out that his players graduated from their institution. They went on to more education. They went on to live great lives. We think about Michael Jordan now as not a basketball player, but rather as an entrepreneur, a businessman. In other words, the things that are learned in your high school and your college career send you forward. This is one of the great answers to the question by ninth graders, why shouldn't I drop out of school, right? That is to say, you should find some way to try to prepare for your future. Remember those lines, of course, from My Heart Leaps Up When I Behold a Rainbow in the Sky. The child is father of the man. That is to say, there's things that we have to learn as young people to teach old people, right? With all of that in mind, then, let's jump quickly now to 2B. Well, what do we want to say at 2B about the rhetorical elements? Well, all of these things that are listed on the sidebar here, for example, notice just 17. I'll just point out 17 on 1038. Notice the sentence patterns. Notice, in what way does the repetition of sentences help emphasize and develop Smith's theme? If another team played harder than we did, notice the construction, even with the parentheses, with the commas. If another team played harder than we did, we had no excuse for it. None. We worked on it in every practice. If a player didn't give maximum effort, we dealt with it right then. We stopped practice and had the entire team run sprints for the offending player. I've had students that say, well, that's grossly unfair. No, it's not. I mean, think about it. It's the way we live in our world, right? If one group of people were to completely destroy a whole bunch of our resources, that affects the rest of the people living on the planet. We are all connected in some way, whether we want to say that we are not or we accept it. It doesn't matter. The reality is we're all in it together. Notice the juxtaposition of the sentencing. Notice it's very punctual to try to emphasize what Dean Smith is trying to say here to us. In other words, he is saying we took it seriously, right? Let's think about the word pictures. What was your favorite word picture here? Some students love that word picture of, okay, one guy keeps jacking up shots, we'll just take the other four guys off and have them sit on the bench. Put the one guy out there. Which is always a funny thing in answer to this idea that you can take the picture of one athlete and put him in or her in the trophy case and he or she is the best player on the team. Every one of the great athletes that are out there that I have taught, all of them over the years, admit absolutely no way I'm in that trophy case unless I had a whole lot of help. First of all, obviously I won the DNA lottery for most of them, right? That is to say, the people who produced me, they had tremendous athleticism and intelligence to help me to be able to perform. But then there's all the other people, all the coaches, all the experiences, all the teammates from the time I was young learning the game. In other words, we're all somehow connected in this thing of the competitive life that we live. We should be aware of that. What was your favorite word picture that went on here? At 3A, jot down, what is for you? I mean, we already mentioned Booker T. Washington's Up for Slavery. I mean, one of the texts of many, many that we could say you could read that would change the way you look at your life. Compelling, compelling biographies. Many biographies and autobiographies are going to teach the same truth, right? What is the text for you that motivates you the most? We've already mentioned Psalm of Life, right? In this world's broad field of battle, in the bivouac of life, be not like dumb, driven cattle. Be a hero in the strife. What is the text for you that motivates you? What is the text for you that kind of awakens in you, reminds you? Why? Because we often say, right, the greatest sin is to forget. That is to say, I know that I should be a better student, but I forget to be a better student. What is it that motivates you to be a better student? Is there a text? Is there a song? Of all the songs on your playlist when you're having a down day, what is the song that motivates you? Now think about the words of that song and ask the simple question. Do the words of that song convince me I should be a better person? Or do the words of that song convince me that I should continue to be an upset, angry person? If you're listening to a song that's constantly telling you how you should continue to be an upset, angry person, you're listening to the wrong song. You're listening to the wrong song. Because it's a simple question. What song are you going to give to your child? When your child comes to you and says, I'm having a bummer day, you're going to give them a song that says, give up, the world's stacked against you? Or are you going to give them a song that says, work harder, work smarter, work more together? What is that? What is that text for you? Is there a video game that you play that motivates you to live a better life? I've often said this to gamers. If you're playing all those hours and that game experience is not motivating you to live a better life, you are wasting your time. find games that motivate. Well, I don't know those games. Then grow up, get a degree, get several degrees, and invent that game. Make that game. That is to say, find ways to leave the world a better place, a more awakened place, a more mindful place, a more aware place, a more compassionate place than you found it. That's the notion. Of course, now it's 3B, to finish our annotative work. What is it for you that's your greatest challenge as a student right now? Why is it that so regularly you convince yourself to quit and give up? Why is it that you say to yourself, I need to be better, but then a week or two later, you have forgotten, and then you have to remind yourself again? Why is that? What is the challenge for you? Is it the people you associate with? Is it the people you don't associate with? Right? The challenge is often not walking away from the friends that you have. That's not often the most healthy way to address it. The better way is to keep the friends you have and make new friends. And if the friends you have are not helping you, find people who do help you. And then in the process of those people helping you, you help your friends. We're all connected. We're all together. We're all somehow a part of this amazing world. Why don't you often feel that way? What are your goals? To what degree do you understand your life as a great competition? And finally, last questions. What is the greatest success to this point in your life? What is your greatest success? What is it that you look at and you go, hey, I didn't do those other things, but at least I did this, at least I did this. That is the one thing I can always say. I at least finished that. I at least completed that. Of course, this is one of the beautiful things about the freshman year, is that at the end of it, you can say, I did it. I did it. Now I get ready for my sophomore year, and I'll begin my sophomore year with the same admonition to myself. I gotta do this thing, but it's not fun. No, no, no. Remember, it is fun, only dependent upon your attitude, yes? That is the challenge. Well, an interesting bit of reading for us, maybe a challenge, I would hope, for us as we get ready now to go forward. We'll turn next to the actual study of Homer's Odyssey, and we'll spend a few moments getting ready to read Homer's Odyssey, a story about a man who had to figure out a way to not give up so that he could get home to Ithaca. Thank you.